I will talk about the econometrics of high-dimensional sparse models, namely models where the number of regressors p is much larger than the sample size. So these lectures were prepared jointly with Chris Hansen, who will later follow up with a battery of empirical examples explaining the details of how you go about applications.
Oh, and Victor, let me just say one other thing about process. So
right. We'll
hold questions till later, otherwise it'll mess up the videotaping. So
right. Maybe
towards the end, we're planning a break around 10:30.
Got it.
So around that time, maybe take some questions and then
okay. Okay.
Thanks.
Right. And so I'll begin with the outline for what I will do. So I have two parts. In part one, I'll talk about the definition of these high-dimensional models. I'll present several motivating examples, hopefully convincing you that those are useful models to use in practice. And then I'll talk about estimation of regression functions via penalization and selection methods. I will focus on the method called Lasso method, and also on the post-selection methods called the post-Lasso methods. Right? So in this part one, we will mostly talk about modeling or estimation of regression functions. And in part two, we will talk about estimation of parameters that we care about. For example, I will talk about estimation of structural parameters in IV regression with many instruments. Right. So there we will use Lasso to select the instruments. And then the main part here will be actually estimation and inference on treatment effects when we have many controls. This is going to be set up in the partially linear framework, and we're going to use Lasso methods to select controls. But this is going to be tricky and probably the most intriguing part of my lecture today. And then towards the end, I'll make it tough on you, and I'll talk about generalizations, and it's going to be difficult, very difficult at the end. All right. So the materials for this lecture include the summer review article called Inference in High-Dimensional Sparse Econometric Models. It came out in the proceedings of the 10th World Congress. It talks about these inferential methods that I'll present today in a very simple manner. Okay. There's also a number of research articles that you can find listed in the references, and I'll be announcing those research articles as I proceed. And also, we plan to make the Stata and MATLAB codes available for all the empirical examples that we present today via our websites. Okay. So let me begin with part one, the high-dimensional sparse framework. This framework could be described as follows. So for the most part, I'll focus on regression, so it's appropriate to introduce this framework in the regression context. In regressions, we have a response variable y. That's our y. We have regressors. These regressors are p-dimensional. So the regressors have p components in them. We also normalize each regressor, each component, to have second moment equal to 1. Right. So this normalization is done to simplify the construction of the Lasso estimator later. This is an innocuous normalization. You can always do it. And what I do this only to simplify the notation later. Okay. So the key property here is that P could be large. The number of regressors could be large and potentially much larger than the sample size. Actually, the theory will allow for that. And with just that, it seems like mission impossible, but actually we will make the assumptions that will make the estimation possible here. The key assumption is going to be sparsity, or later, approximate sparsity. And the sparsity says that the number of relevant regressors that appears here is much smaller than the sample size. So we consider a lot of regressors, but only S of them are going to be relevant, and this S is going to be much smaller than the sample size. So here, let me explain this notation. So here, what we're saying here is that, so let's look at this coefficient beta naught, and what we do here, we count the number of non-zero components in beta, right? So this is denoted by zero norm of beta. It's actually a pseudonorm, but this is our S, yes. And so the number of non-zero components in this vector beta naught is much smaller than the sample size, or the number of relevant regressors is also much smaller than the sample size. So obviously, this generalizes the traditional parametric framework used in economics, empirical economics, by allowing the identity of the most relevant regressors to be unknown. Right. So we don't know this identity, and we're going to try to figure out this identity, at least approximately. We're not going to be able to perfectly figure it out using modern model selection method, but we will try to find these relevant regressors, at least approximately. So what I'll do next, I'll try to motivate a little bit the high P setup, the menu regressor setup, and then after that, I will try to motivate the approximately sparse setup. So how do we come by with a very high dimensional P? We could generate high dimensional P or high P in two ways. One is by taking transformations of basic regressors, so you could have basic regressors, ZI, such as, for example, education and experience. And then in the final regressions, you're going to be using polynomials, various polynomials, and then interactions of those polynomials in education and experience. If you have other socio-demographic factors also as basic regressors, you throw them in, and also you could take polynomial transformations and interactions and so on. So even though the set of basic regressors you have could be small, the final set of technical regressors could be quite large. So this is one way of coming up with a high P. Another way of coming up with a high P is that it might be just a feature of the data sets, and it's quite often a feature of the modern data sets, including even the classical data sets. So for example, if we go to the Bar-Li data set used in cross-country growth analysis, if you look at the list of country characteristics, it's very large compared to the sample size. Right. So it's actually, in econometrics, when we say the number of regressors is large, it means it's at least proportional. Well, it's large relative to the it's either proportional or bigger than the sample size, right? And so in that data set, it is proportional to the sample size. So the and I'll get back to that example later. So in American housing survey, the list of housing characteristics is large. So if you want to run hedonic regressions, and also in modern scanner data, the price and product characteristics are also high dimensional. Chris will talk about the eminent domain application. There, the judge characteristics are also very high dimensional, and we need to deal with that. So the judge characteristics will be used as instruments, and we will need to select amongst those judge characteristics to estimate the economic impacts of eminent domain. So let me get to sparsity. Let me get back to sparsity. So as I said, the key assumption behind sparsity is that the number of non-zero regression coefficients in the model is much smaller than the sample size. So what does this assumption say? So the idea behind this assumption is that there is this low dimensional, S-dimensional to be precise, submodel that accurately approximates the full p-dimensional model. In fact, the approximation error is just zero, right? So we actually, this is appealing, but we may not like the fact that the approximation error is zero. Because, well, we may not like the fact that, well, somehow some coefficients are positive and or non-zero and the rest are just zero, so why is this? Intuitively, like all coefficients should be non-zero, but a lot of them are going to be large and a lot of them are going to be small, so what's going on here, right? So we may not like this assumption, right? And the model that relaxes this exact sparsity assumption is going to be the approximately sparse model, where we're going to allow for non-trivial approximation error. So we're going to write the outcome variable y equals to the regression function, and then the regression function is going to be split in two parts. One part is going to be the sparse approximation, right? And this is going to be approximation error. This is a disturbance. And this parametric sparse approximation will have sparsity index S, which counts the number of non-zero components in this approximations to be smaller than the sample size. This is the precise sense in which we need S to be smaller than the sample size, so S log P divided by N has to go to zero, okay? And by the way, S, in making asymptotic analysis, we allow S to increase with the sample size. So this S is not fixed. If you're not familiar with this framework, think about a simple case where S is fixed, but just to get used to the to this formulation. But if you know series estimation, you would appreciate the fact that S is going S could be increasing with the sample size, but it has to be small in comparison to the sample size. Okay. And then the assumption on the approximation, error here is going to be that the size of the approximation error, this is the size of the approximation error, the L2 norm of this error, has to be no bigger than the size of the conjectured estimation error. And this is actually conjectured estimation error for the regression function. So it's sigma square root S divided by N. So S is the effective number of parameters, N is the sample size, right? So this approximation error has to be smaller than the estimation error. So this is the definition of the approximately sparse model. And to give you a theoretical example of how you come up with such a model, let me show you this example. In this example, we have a response variable y. We have infinite number of regressors, a lot of regressors, infinite number of regressors. And none of them have zero coefficients. So all the coefficients are actually non-zero, but the coefficients, they decay nicely to zero. So the coefficients in absolute value are majorated. So let me explain this notation. This notation throughout my presentation means less than or equal up to a constant, j into the power of minus a. So these coefficients decay nicely to zero. And obviously, this model is approximately sparse because you only need S regressors with largest coefficients to get a good approximation of the entire regression function, where you set S to be proportional to N to this power 1 over 2a. And if you do a little bit of calculation, you will see that the resulting size of the approximation error is going to be no larger than this quantity here. This is what we wanted. So this example gives you the approximately sparse model, which is what we will work with. So I will present all of my results for this approximately sparse model and not for the exactly sparse model. But if you want to explain your friend what is a sparse model, you probably want to start out with an explanation that where you have exact sparsity, right? You just say, well, there's a lot of regressors and only S of them are relevant. So this approximately sparse model obviously generalizes the exactly sparse model by letting in a non-zero approximation error. It also generalizes the traditional series or sieve estimation by letting the identity of the most important series terms to be unknown. Okay. So typically in series estimation, if you're familiar with it, we make a stance on the first S terms being the most important terms. The first S series terms are the most important terms. And here we don't make a stance. We just consider very many series terms. And we're going to look for the important ones. They could appear early in the series or late in the series or in the middle of the series, anywhere, right? So in that sense, we're nicely nesting the traditional series or sieve approach that has been popular in econometrics in the last 15 years or so. Okay. So let me give you the following example. It's going to be about series modeling of wage functions. In this example, I'm going to abstract away completely from estimation questions because I will use population or census data. So I will pretend that I don't have estimation error there. And also, in order to visualize the idea of approximate sparsity, the example is going to be highly contrived. Okay, so I just want to show you things in pictures, and for that purpose, it's going to be a very simplified example. What we want to do, we want to build a series approximation to the conditional expectation of wage given education. So wage is y, education is z. And the conventional series approximation in labor would be as follows. So you write the conditional expectation of education, wage given education is equal to an intercept plus first polynomial, second polynomial, third polynomial. Sometimes people don't put the third polynomial, typically just a quadratic, linear quadratic approximation. And then the hope is that, well, this resulting approximation is small, and this is kind of a traditional parsimonious approximation. Obviously, this is also a sparse model. And let's see how it works in the real data. So if we go to US census data, year 2000, prime age white man, we get the following results. On this horizontal axis, we have education levels. Here we have wages. And so we go cell by cell and compute the conditional expectation of wage given education. And this gives us this black curve. So this is the true conditional expectation function of wage given education, right? So you see this. It makes a dip here at 17 years of schooling. This is what happens if you don't get PhD. This is what happens. This is what happens if you get PhD. So this is a true function, and this red curve, red dotted curve, is what you get from the traditional approximation by low degree polynomial. And as you could see here, what happens is that the overall shape is captured very correctly by this approximation. Low degree polynomial approximation fails to capture these oscillations or zigzags that you see at 17 and 18 years of schooling. Right? So it gets the overall shape right, but misses these important features here. Okay. So then our question would be, can we find a much better series approximation keeping the same number of parameters? Right. How can we describe this function with the same number of parameters, but much more accurately? So we can succeed if somehow we can capture these oscillations, right? So formally, to capture those oscillations, what we do, we consider a very long expansion of this conditional expectation function. So we take a very large collection of polynomials and dummy variables, and we're going to shop around for just a few terms that capture the overall shape as well as the oscillations. And formally, we will do this by using the Lasso method. The Lasso method finds the parsimonious model by minimizing squared errors while penalizing the size of the model through by the sum of the absolute values of the coefficients, right? Okay. And in this example, we can also find the right terms by eyeballing. Right. More generally, the eyeballing technique would not be available to us, but here we can also do this by eyeballing. Simply, we could say, well, to get the overall shape right, we just fit a linear line through data, and then we throw in dummy variables at 17 and 17, and then 19 years of schooling to capture the deviations from the smooth trend. Right? It's obvious, right? And actually, the Lasso method will actually automatically do this obvious thing. It will actually find this parsimonious approximation for us. This is the Lasso approximation to this the target function. Obviously, it does better than the original approximation. If we look at the maximal approximation error, the conventional series approximation gives us 0.29 error. Lasso-based series approximation gives us a maximal error of 0.06, so this is five times smaller, right, with the same number of parameters. If we look at the root mean squared errors, the same great reduction, four times reduction. Right. Okay. So hopefully, this example conveys what is the idea of the approximately sparse model. So this wedge function is approximately sparse. And it also shows you how you can nest and expand the traditional framework, which relies on parsimony, right? So the traditional framework is this red curve, and by using this more general framework, we're not losing anything; we're just gaining, right? Okay. So I'm done. I'm done with the modeling part, the motivational part, and what I'll do next, I will talk about estimation of regression functions arising in these models. I will not have access to the population data, so I cannot compute things exactly. And so we have a finite sample available, and we want to estimate a sparse regression function. How do we do this? So we do this by penalization or selection. It's a generally good idea to do a selection or penalization when p is large, right? It's obviously a good idea when p is bigger than the sample size, because if you don't penalize or you don't do selection, you will perfectly fit the data and you end up with inconsistent estimates. But it's actually also a good idea when p is smaller than n, but is substantial, right? P is substantial. It's actually a good idea to do selection or regularization to avoid overfitting, right? And a nice formal way of doing selection, at least on the paper, is this BIC approach. This is actually a classical approach. Here we minimize the following criterion function. So this is the least squares discrepancy function, and this is a penalty. So here we're penalizing by the number of parameters in the model. So here, this is a vector beta, and this norm counts the number of non-zero components. In this vector, lambda is the penalty level. And so this is, in some sense, this is an ideal way to do model selection and penalization at the same time. Unfortunately, this approach is not computationally tractable, especially when p is large, and we are in a setting where p is large. Formally, this is known as NP-hard, which means computationally intractable. Basically, you have to do combinatorial search to solve this optimization problem, and this is just not possible in any practical times. You need supercomputers to do this, and even supercomputers wouldn't be able to solve the problems like this. So what to do? A solution was proposed by Frank and Friedman and Tipshirani. The solution was to provide the convex relaxation of this problem, ideal problem. And what we do there, we replace this unpleasant penalty function by a more pleasant one. It's actually closest convex function, the L1 norm function. So the Lasso estimator minimizes this criterion function. This is the discrepancy function, and this is the penalty function. So the penalty function has these two components. This lambda is the penalty level. Beta one, and this is the L1 norm. This is the sum of the absolute values of the coefficients, right? So this problem is nice because it's globally convex. You have a convex function plus another convex function. The sum of convex functions is convex. It's computable in polynomial time, means it's it is easy to compute. So it's the computational complexity is comparable actually to the least squares. So this is nice. And also this the kinked nature of this penalty function induces the solution beta hat of this optimization problem to have lots of zeros. I'll explain this in more detail later, but the solution will have lots of zeros, And so people use lasso as a model selection device for these reasons, right? So they just throw out the regressors for which the solution is zero, right? So we throw out all the components for which the parameter estimate is equal to zero, and this is how we use lasso as a model selection device. Also, people often use lasso as an estimator, not as a selection device. They just say, well, it simultaneously does selection, variable selection, and penalization, so we can also use lasso as an estimator. So, and we will talk about using lasso both as an estimator and as a selection device. Okay. Right. So if we look at the formulation here, it looks very nice, but obviously we realize that it's not a complete formulation of the lasso yet because we haven't specified the penalty level yet, right? How do we choose the penalty level in practice? And this is actually not an easy thing to do. Bikel, Ritov, and Sabakov, in their Annals of Statistics paper 2009, they worked out the right optimal choice of penalty level. This penalty level could be set as follows. So the penalty level equals to sigma, which is the standard deviation of the errors, regression errors. So you know, so far we're assuming that the errors are homoscedastic. So sigma is the standard deviation of the errors, and then we have this factor here, which has nice numbers in them. So there's log of p divided by n. So it's very simple. The only annoying part here is the sigma, which is unknown. So this is a typical advice that you get from econometricians. You go to them, you ask like, what's the penalty level, and they tell you, well, it's this, and then you say, what is sigma, and say, well, I don't know, like, go figure it out. Yeah. So this choice relies on knowing sigma, which may be hard to estimate when p is bigger than n, but. We have worked on this in a number of settings. So one way to estimate it would be by iteration. You start with a conservative value, and then you get the initial level of the penalty. You get the initial pilot estimates, lasso estimates, and then you re-estimate the sigma as the standard deviation of residuals, and you keep iterating in this way. So this is a very simple procedure, and it's been proven to have the same like rate optimal properties. Another thing that you could do is cross-validation. In all practical experiments, computational experiments, it performs quite well. Unfortunately, there is no proof yet that this method is consistent, so theoretical validity. So the theoretical validity is a nice open question. It's a nice, could be nice paper to write. Right. That's that. So this is lasso. Okay. So there's another formulation of lasso, which is which avoids dealing with sigma completely, and this is obtained by reformulating the lasso just a little bit. So if we take the square root of this first part and add the same penalty function as before, this is called the root lasso. And so we get this globally convex objective function. So this is kind of a least squares criterion function with a square root in it. This is a penalty function. And it turns out that with this slight reformulation of lasso, you could specify this penalty level completely independently of sigma. So this penalty level does not involve any like user-specified parameters, right? And so this is a nice formulation for practice. So it's tuning-free. It's both parts here are convex. This is a norm. This is another norm. The sum of two norms. So the norms are convex, and this, obviously the sum is also convex. It's polynomial time computable, just like lasso. So in fact, the computational time is very similar to lasso, sometimes even faster. And the code for this is also available. So this is another practical suggestion for dealing with unknown sigma. And I will show you theoretical results for lasso and Bose, and also for root lasso. But before I show you these theoretical results, I will do two things. First, I will present to you some heuristics that will explain how lasso manages to zero out how lasso manages to throw out a lot of variables, and why do we get zeros as solutions. And secondly, I will talk about heteroscedasticity. So I want to describe what happens under heteroscedasticity. So far, the setup has been homoscedastic, but if we wanna work with real economic data, it's typically heteroscedastic. So we want to deal with this. So I want to explain those two points before I state some theoretical results. Okay, so let me give you some heuristics, and it's going to be done for the simple case. So we have a response variable y equals to x beta naught, but all the beta naughts are going to be equal to zero here, just to keep things simple, plus a disturbance. So this is obviously a sparse model where none of the regressors are important, none of the regressors are relevant. And what we want the lasso to do, we want the lasso to tell us that these regressors are not relevant. Right, and the claim is that if we set the penalty level to an appropriate level, the lasso solution will actually be identically equal to zero in this case. So the lasso will correctly zero out all the components and give you this nice solution of zero. Right? So how do we show this? Well, first we plot the discrepancy function, the least squares discrepancy function in this case. So this is kind of a one-dimensional example, or you could think about this picture as being a slice of a higher dimensional picture. So this is the true value. This is zero. This is the true value. This is the least squares criterion function, and in high dimensions, obviously, this criterion function could be minimized at a point which is very far away from the truth, right? Very far away from the truth, and it's not theoretically, it's very hard to control the behavior of this least squares criterion function, because well, if p is larger than n, what do you do? Like what laws of large numbers do you use? But what we can do here, we can work with the supporting hyperplane at the true parameter value. And we know the supporting hyperplane dominates the behavior of this criterion function by the convexity. Right? So we get this dominance. And what we can do next, we bend this supporting hyperplane into this function, the blue curve, and you see that the functional expression for this blue curve could be written as lambda times the L1 norm of beta. So somehow we bended the supporting hyperplane into the penalty term, and we can so this lambda is the slope, the maximal slope of this criterion at this point at the true parameter value. So formally, this is a maximal norm of the gradient of the criterion, the discrepancy function, evaluated at beta naught. So this is, this gives us this bended supporting hyperplane, which is also the penalty term. We could bend it a little bit more, so we set the lambda to be bigger than this, and then we get this function. And now what we do. So this is a discrepancy function, this is penalty function. If we add them up, we get this red. We get this red function that is uniquely minimized at zero. So we set the penalty level enough so that the resulting red curve is uniquely minimized at zero, and so the lasso correctly zeroes out all the components. So this, and so you see this kink, it survives there, right? With a large enough penalty. Right. So this heuristics explains why lasso will successfully zero out lots of irrelevant regressors. Okay. But I want to say that, like right at the outset, that it won't be perfect. The lasso will not be perfect at model selection. And no procedure can be perfect, because there's no procedure that could tell a parameter that is local to zero from zero. It's theoretically impossible. So if you read any results saying that they get a model selection technique that can perfectly recover the true model, that's not true. It's just theoretically impossible. They're probably making some assumptions, allowing them the recovery, but these assumptions, they probably they create a firewall. Essentially, you need like very large coefficients that are all bounded away from zero. In those cases, you could do perfect recovery. But I never buy those assumptions where a lot of coefficients are large and the rest is zero. I always think of cases where coefficients decay to zero, and some of them will be local to zero, and therefore you would not be able to perfectly tell them apart from zero. So it's impossible to do perfect model selection. But this heuristic does explain why lasso zeroes out a lot of variables. Right. This heuristic also explains how we set the penalty level. We set the penalty level to dominate the norm of this subgradient at the true parameter value. Right. So this is the subgradient of the discrepancy function. This is the maximal norm. And then we set the penalty level to be larger than this maximal norm. In fact, we set the penalty level so that this statement holds with probability approaching 1. And the penalty levels that I described to you before, they exactly implement this choice. So these nice expressions that you've seen, they precisely implement this rule. Okay. So these heuristics also explain why in the case of root lasso you don't get the penalty level to depend on sigma. So in the case of root lasso, the discrepancy function is this, right? So it's the square root of the least squares criterion function, and when we take the gradient here, we get the self-normalization. So you take the gradient, the square root goes, you take the derivative, the square root goes in the denominator. In the numerator, you have this expression. So you have sigma appearing both here. So this is so this sigma is implicitly embedded here in the epsilon and here. So it appears both in the numerator and denominator, and therefore it cancels, right? It cancels, and therefore, in the choice, in the case of root lasso, the choice of lambda shouldn't depend on sigma. So, in some sense, the root lasso is kind of maybe the right formulation of lasso. Okay. All right. So we get to heteroscedasticity. Okay, so let's generalize the previous model to the case where we have the outcome variable y related to the regression function plus an approximation error plus a disturbance. And this disturbance, like before, has conditional mean zero. But now variance is going to depend on I. So it's going to have an index I. So it could be either conditional heteroscedasticity or a more general kind of heteroscedasticity. So we want to deal with heteroscedasticity because it seems to be like common in all empirical problems in economics, right? And there are modifications of lasso and root lasso for dealing with heteroscedasticity. I want to say here, well, I put stars on everything that is hard, so this is a difficult slide. If you're not very familiar with all the language I'm using here, and this is very unfamiliar territory for you, well, feel free to just relax a little bit. But if you're plugged in, stay tuned. So the way we specify heteroscedastic lasso, we modify the penalty function as follows. So we introduce data-driven penalty loadings. So we introduce this weighting matrix here, sigma psi hat. And the psi hat is a diagonal weighting matrix with entries on a diagonal that contain these moments here, empirical moments. What are these moments? Well, this is a cross product of the second moment of the regressor and the second moment of the disturbance. So this is the jth component of the regressor, and this is epsilon I, and then we have j running from 1 to p. So this is a diagonal matrix with p entries in the diagonal like this. And what happens under homoscedasticity? Well, we've normalized the second moments of components to be 1. And under homoscedasticity, the epsilon I squared will be uncorrelated with the second moment. So what happens is that under homoscedasticity, this penalty level will simplify approximately to the previous penalty levels. But more generally, it won't. And and this is actually the right penalty level to use here, because if we go and work out the supremum norm of the gradient, this is going to be the supremum norm of the gradient, and with the penalty loadings that I described, it's going to have this nice self-normalized form, and so we can set the penalty level in a neat fashion. And here we will rely on moderate deviation theory for self-normalized sums to guarantee that the penalty level dominates the maximal norm of gradient with a high probability, under very weak assumptions on p, so log p could be a little or n to the 1/3, and also under the weak assumptions on the moments. So for example, we need this third moment assumption, but not much more than that. Okay, so under weak assumptions, we were able to set the penalty level by using this data-driven penalty loadings. Now, as far as the details go here, we specify the penalty loadings like this. But what happens? You see this specification entails the true disturbances, which we don't observe. But again, they could be estimated in an iterative fashion. You could initialize the disturbances to be deviations from the sample mean. You can initialize the initial penalty loadings to be this. Then you obtain the initial level. So initial lasso estimator better hat by using those penalty loadings. Then you update the residuals, you update the penalty loadings, and then you could iterate. And we have proven that this procedure works. And there is also heteroscedastic form. So this is lasso. There is also heteroscedastic form of root lasso. Okay. So I need the slide, because Chris later on will present empirical applications, and in those empirical applications we are using this formulation, the heteroscedastic formulation. But obviously, for explanations, the earlier slides were nicer. This is quite tough. Okay, so this is that. Okay, so before I announce some of the theoretical properties, I want to introduce. Well, I want to do some recap here. So, due to kink in the penalty, function, lasso and or variance of lasso will successfully zero out lots of irrelevant regressors. But again, don't expect it to be perfect. Also, lasso. So I didn't describe that, but essentially, because of the penalty level, because there's penalization involved, lasso will shrink the non-zero coefficients towards non-zero, right? So it zeroes out a lot of variables, but the ones that it didn't zero out, it will shrink them towards zero. So this might be unpleasant. So sometimes what people do, they do least squares after lasso, right? So this is the post-model selection estimator, the post-lasso estimator. So formally, in step one, you select the model using lasso and or various versions of lasso, and in step two, you apply the ordinary least squares to the selected model. And what this does, this undoes the shrinkage bias. So, and you'll see in the Monte Carlo experiments that improves the performance of the lasso estimator quite a bit. Okay, I'm moving to the statement of the theoretical results. And I don't want to give you all the regularity conditions, because you can find them in the papers. These regularity conditions are method specific. But I do want to give you a sense of what's required for the results to hold. And I do want to give you an example. I want to give you a flavor of the of the regularity conditions that you need to impose on the axis, on the regressors. Okay. Right. Again, this is an advanced slide. So let's look at this matrix M. This is this is what we call Gram matrix. This is X prime X matrix divided by N, or equivalently this. So just the average of Xi, Xi primes. It's a P by P matrix, right? So it's a very large matrix. And when P is larger than N, obviously this matrix is not very well behaved. It's singular. The smallest eigenvalue is zero, the largest eigenvalue is probably very large. But we don't need the behavior we don't need to control the behavior of the entire matrix. We don't need the good behavior of eigenvalues. What we need is good behavior of the so-called sparse eigenvalues. We need the good behavior of much smaller submatrices. So roughly speaking, we will need the good behavior of all S by S submatrices. Okay. So formally, we're going to take this constant C bigger than 1, and we're going to look at S times C submatrices and compute their eigenvalues. And what we need is that these eigenvalues are bounded away from 0 and infinity. And remember, S is much smaller than the sample size. So when we look at the submatrices, these are small neat submatrices that that we hope are well behaved. And this is going to be sufficient condition. All right. So how do we do this sparse eigenvalue computation? Well, it looks like a standard eigenvalue computation. We take this M matrix, hit it by delta and before and after. Normalized by the delta transpose delta, and then we minimize over delta. But then the minimization over delta is not done over the full p-dimensional space. It is done over sparse subspaces. So here we restrict the zero norm of delta to be smaller than S times C. Right. So effectively, this means that only S times C components of delta could be non-zero. And so effectively, we're only looking at smaller submatrices of M when we're doing this eigenvalue computation. So this is a minimal sparse eigenvalue, and this needs to be bounded away from zero. Likewise, the maximal sparse eigenvalue needs to be bounded away from infinity, right? So this is the regularity condition. So it's an example of a sufficient condition. Actually, it's not the weakest condition possible, but it is a nice sufficient condition that has been proven to hold under various primitive assumptions. So if you take if you draw axis from a normal distribution with a non-singular variance matrix, then you just need S log P to be of little order n in order for these assumptions to hold with a large probability. So again, we actually need this we need this to hold with probability approaching 1 for any C bigger than 1. Okay. Likewise, if regressors are bounded and this condition, technical condition, holds, this condition on sparse eigenvalues also holds with high probability. This has been proven by Rudolph and Vershini. These people work in functional analysis, so you see that there's a lot of attention devoted to these problems and coming from very different fields. Okay, so this is a sufficient condition. And so here's the first theoretical result. Under practical regularity conditions that include, for example, the condition that I just stated, plus some standard moment assumptions. So for example, we need errors to have 4 plus delta moments. Under the assumption that log P is of little order n to the 1/3. So P is the overall number of regressors here. And what we need is that log of P to be small and compared to the n to the 1/3. obviously this allows for very large p, right? So p could be much larger than n, but after you take the log, it has to be smaller than n to the 1/3 power. So under these regularity conditions, you get that with probability approaching to 1, the following statement holds. So here we have this, this is the target regression function. This is the Lasso estimate of this target regression function. This is the L2 error. And so we recover the regression function, the target regression function, with this accuracy. So this statement means that this quantity is smaller than this quantity up to a constant, unspecified constant. So what is this quantity? This quantity is sigma. Here we have square root. In the denominator we have n. So this is expected, right? 1 over root n is kind of expected. Square root of s appears here. Well, s, the dimension of the problem must show up somehow, and it does show up, right? Like as a square root s. And then we have, and then the way p shows up here is as a logarithmic factor, log p. We have the log p present here. Also, so this is the rate for estimating the function. If you also look at the rate of estimating the coefficient vector, the entire coefficient vector in the Euclidean norm, so this is Euclidean norm, you estimate the entire vector of coefficients also with the same precision. Right. So this is this statement contains both the rate result for the coefficients, for all of them actually, in the Euclidean norm, and the rate for the regression function. So this rate is close to the so-called the oracle rate, square root s over n. So the oracle knows the identity of the relevant regressors. Right, so the oracle can run the least squares and estimate this regression function at this rate, square root s over n. And what we get is something very close, which is square root s over n, but times the log p factor. And so this rate is called near oracle rate. We're not doing as well as the oracle, but we're doing nearly as well as the oracle, right? And again, the log p here, the p only shows up through the logarithmic factor. So we can think of log p as being the price of not knowing the true model, the price of not knowing the relevant regressors, right? So this result has been established by Bikel-Ritev and Sabakov for Gaussian errors, and has been extended to heteroscedastic setup and non-Gaussian errors in a sequence of follow-up papers that I'm listing here. Okay. So this is the rate for Lasso, and as well as for all of its modifications that I have shown to you so far, right? What about the post-Lasso or the post-model selection estimator? Again, a quick reminder, in step one, we select the model using Lasso, and the post-Lasso estimator is obtained in step two, where we apply the ordinary least squares to the selected model. Lasso is not going to be perfect at model selection. So for example, it might include junk regressors. It might miss some relevant regressors. And the analysis of the post-Lasso method that I'll show you is going to account for the possibility of making those model selection errors. Okay? So here's the result. So this is the rate result for the post-selection estimator. Under the practical regularity conditions, such as the one that I've shown to you, with probability approaching to 1, we have the following statement holding. So this is very similar to what you've seen before. This is the L2 rate for estimating the target regression function. This is x better not. This is our estimate, the post-Lasso estimate of the regression function. This is the Euclidean distance between the post-Lasso estimate of beta naught and beta naught itself. And so either this quantity or this quantity are smaller than this quantity up to an unspecified constant. where this quantity is the same expression that you've seen before, square root s over n, the oracle rate, times the square root of log n max p. So this is the oracle rate, this is price of not knowing the true model. Fortunately, the price is small, only shows up as a log. And moreover, under some further exceptional cases, namely, like if you have a well-separated model where the signal is so strong and you have a lot of nice zeros, in those cases, Lasso will start doing a perfect job at model selection. In those cases, the post-Lasso estimator will be the oracle estimator with probability converging to one. And so in those exceptional cases, you get this nice rate. But because we're not doing a perfect job at model selection, we're paying this price here, the square root log p, more generally, right? So this result might seem surprising because, well, I just stated on the previous slide that Lasso is not perfect at model selection and it might miss relevant regressors. And so this might seem like a contradiction, like, well, the post-Lasso, we screwed up the model estimation, or sorry, model selection, and how come the post-model selection estimator achieves the same nice near oracle rate? Well, yeah, it might seem counterintuitive, but actually, if you look at this result, it is very intuitive, because in the first place, the Lasso couldn't have achieved this rate if it omitted very important regressors. It could have only omitted regressors that have relatively small coefficients. Yeah, they could be relevant, but because they have like relatively small coefficients, their omission does not destroy this rate, and therefore the post-Lasso estimator still manages to do this good job at estimating the regression function with the same accuracy. And this result for the post-model selection estimator was derived in the joint work with Alex Belloni. It was published in Bernoulli and also extended to heteroscedastic non-Gaussian cases in this paper, which is by Belloni, Chen, Hansen, and myself. Okay. So this is the second main result. Let me go to the Monte Carlo experiments that will illustrate these results. So in this Monte Carlo experiment, I'll have 100 observations. Number of regressors is going to be 500. S, the number of relevant regressors is going to be 6. The errors here are Gaussian, with mean 0 and variance sigma squared. This parameter vector beta naught is specified as follows. So we have 6 non-zeros and the rest are zeros, just to make it simple. But to make it difficult, we have the following entries. So it's 1, 1, and then 1, 2, 1 over 3, 1 over 4, 1 over 5. So it's a decaying sequence. And so the idea behind the specification is that, well, it's actually in this Monte Carlo experiment, it's going to be hard for Lasso to find this regressor or find this regressor. So occasionally we will be missing this regressor or that regressor. And occasionally we'll also be including some junk regressors that have zero coefficients. So it'll actually be an interesting Monte Carlo setup. The axes are gonna be drawn for a multivariate normal, allowing for some non-trivial correlation. So actually, formally, it's a toplet covariance matrix. So think about like autoregressive structure generating the regressors, dependency among the regressors. So this is a toplet matrix. Okay. So the benchmark here is going to be the oracle estimator. So the oracle knows this knows that the first six regressors have non-zero coefficients, and the oracle will just use the first six regressors in estimation. So we look first at the prediction error. So this is the error of estimating the regression function. This is the oracle prediction error. This is the Lasso prediction error. And this is the post-Lasso prediction error. Right. So I would argue that both post-Lasso and Lasso come near oracle, so they do deliver near oracle performance, but somehow post-Lasso does a lot better here than Lasso. And neither one of them is identical to the oracle, right? So it's near oracle performance, but not oracle. So this is consistent with our theoretical results. Also, to explain the difference between lasso and post-lasso, we could look at the bias. So if we look at the bias, which is we compute the expected value of beta hat minus beta naught, and we compute the norm, what happens is that the bias for post-lasso is much smaller than the bias for lasso. And this occurs because of definition of the post-lasso. Post-lasso unshrinks the lasso estimates. So the lasso shrinks the estimates a lot towards zero, and then the lasso unshrinks them back. And so it undoes a huge bias that is caused by shrinkage. It doesn't completely eliminate the bias because here this post-lasso estimator is not fully unbiased because it's not an oracle estimator because the perfect model selection does not happen here. So occasionally we make model selection errors, small ones, I call those moderate selection errors, and therefore some bias shows up here, okay, for the post-lasso estimator. So the post-lasso outperforms lasso, and this is the reason that we often use the post-lasso estimator in practice. So in fact, in all of our empirical examples, we're using the post-lasso method because it seems to perform better than the lasso estimator. And I guess the main message from the theoretical results as well as from this picture is that lasso is not perfect at model selection, but it does find good models that guarantee the near oracle performance of the post-lasso estimator. So that wraps up my part one. And in part two, I will talk about application of these results to estimation of parameters that we care about. The first one is going to be estimation of structural parameters in IV framework, where we're going to use instrument selection. And the second part of my presentation will be about estimation of treatment effects when we have many controls, and it's going to be set up in a partially linear framework. So hopefully that part will be the most interesting part, I hope.